Welcome to the Defense and Aerospace Report. I'm Vago Muradian here at the Wilson Center in Washington, D.C. at the conclusion of a fascinating panel discussion on cyber disinformation and more. And one of those participants was Nina Jankowicz, who is with the Wilson Center, and she is the very first disinformation fellow,
that's
which
true.
I think is a very, very cool.
That's
not fake news. That's actually real news. Nina, talk to us a little bit about the space. You know, as we were talking about and we've been covering for a long time, if you look at information, it is a strategic weapon. It's right up there with nuclear weapons in terms of the potential devastation to societies, not in a physical sense, but in a cohesion sense. Russia has been very, very effective at using a whole variety of tools, as you mentioned in a part of the conversation. You know, they back left, right, center, all of them all the time simultaneously to cause unrest. And we've seen that wreckage, whether it's through Brexit, whether it's to the U.S. presidential election. Efforts are continuing in 2020. Certainly Central and Eastern Europe have borne the brunt of some of these Russian efforts. Talk to us about, and there are a lot of people who compare what the Russians are doing today with what they did in the Cold War. Talk to us about what's different about how they're operating and why it's even more dangerous today.
Right. Well, I think in the Cold War, we were looking at sort of a beta version of this sort of interference. It was through newspapers, it was through radio, et cetera, et cetera. What's different is two things. One, the tactics that are behind it. Not only are they using information warfare through means like RT and Sputnik, but they're using the very trenchant micro-targeting tools that are afforded to pretty much everybody who has a social media account, right? You can target a message to the person who's most likely to find that message appealing, and that's a scary thing. But also, the goal is different. In the past, the Soviet Union was looking to put forward its vision of the world. Today, Russia, as you very adeptly described, is on all sides of the political spectrum trying to discredit the democratic system and cause distrust so that people just don't want to go out and vote anymore. Democracy doesn't work when people aren't voting, when people aren't engaged with the system, doing their civic duty. And that's what is very, very scary to me about the information ecosystem that we find ourselves in today, because we're seeing declining levels of trust across the board, and that's exactly what Russia is weaponizing. Russia and Eastern Europe have been dealing with this for decades. They've had a lot of experience in it since the Soviet Union. So in some ways, they were a little bit more awake to the threat, not only Russian citizens, but the people in Russia's environs, right? So the book that I wrote that's coming out in July, called How to Lose the Information War, is about how governments have dealt with that threat. And some of them have done better than others. I think the governments that have a whole of government, whole of society approach to dealing with disinformation have a better shot at overcoming this problem than the ones who approach it just as a kinetic threat and are playing whack-a-troll, just deleting accounts.
I love your explanation of whack-a-troll, which at the end of the day doesn't work. But what are some of the techniques that were most effective, right? Finland and Scandinavia have been looking at greater education so that consumers of news and information are much more savvy. They don't fall for deep fakes, for example, as easily. But that also takes a lot of effort, right? And the reason we trade away privacy is we want convenience at the end of the day. What are some techniques that have been demonstrated to work better than others?
Well, I think, again, that whole of society approach, when we're looking at governments like Finland that you mentioned, or Estonia and Ukraine, both have had successful approaches to media literacy, digital literacy, that's an important component, but it is a generational component. One thing that we can say that definitely doesn't work is banning things across the board. When governments try to restrict access to information, essentially they're just taking an anti-democratic approach to something that is a democratic problem, right? And we should be using the tenets of democracy to fix it, not quash speech. We need to be looking at ways to preserve that freedom of speech that disinformation so threatens. And so looking at that, we need, you know, coordinated solutions. We need the private sector to be working with governments on this rather than resisting regulation. And I think we're getting to that in the United States, finally, 3 years after 2016. And we need civil society to kind of picking up the rear, so to speak, and not only educating people, journalists like yourself, shedding awareness not only on this problem, but sticking to the facts and truth. That's really important. There is no silver bullet, unfortunately. There are some countries that have better federal electoral law that allow them to have more control over the information space surrounding elections, but this isn't just an election period problem. And it deals with social cohesion and societal resilience overall, which is really difficult to wave your magic wand and fix. But I think, you know, the more that our legislators are having conversations with their constituents about this, realizing that this is not a political issue, but again, a democratic one, and then all the other factions of society holding that up, you know, the closer we're going to be to solving the problem. We're never going to get to an ideal situation, right? And I don't, I think sometimes people bristle at the fact that I want to educate people. They don't want to be educated into submission. But I think we need sort of a healthy sort of criticism in the society. We're never going to get the people who are conspiracy theorists, but the people in the middle who really do want to engage in good faith, they should be our target audience, and that's what we should be legislating and creating programs around.
All of this, almost all of this, is in cyberspace. Northrop Grumman is our cyber sponsor, and we produce once a week a cyber report to try to help educate both senior leaders and regular folks on better cyber habits. What kind of cyber education system do we need at an earlier level, and how early is too early? Because kids are now growing up with smartphones in their hands. That's how they're getting their information. They're not going to newspapers. They're barely even walking to libraries anymore because a smartphone is really a gateway to, the internet and all the research that you can do on it. You can get your homework. You can file your homework at the end of the day using a smart device or a computer. How do we need to, you think, structure cyber education at a very early level to make sure that folks are learning these important life skills that may be kind of harder to apply later in life?
Yeah. Well, I think there's just basic cyber hygiene approaches that everybody should use, that we should be teaching children from a very young age as well, so that that becomes a practice in their life, just like brushing your teeth, you know, logging in with two-factor authentication, things like that, making sure that your password is complex. I mean, I grew up on a very different computer system than one that's available today, but, you know, saving your work on a floppy disk was something that you learned to do as you were writing your book report in fifth grade, and there needs to be similar sort of education, and I am actually kind of heartened by the fact that sort of education is kind of intrinsic to kids growing up today. I think that's a good thing. We just need to be very deliberate and aware of those approaches growing up, and look at systems like in Finland and in Sweden, that where folks have been educated from a very young age about digital and media literacy. We need to develop a curriculum for this, though, and right now that doesn't exactly exist, certainly not on a national level. There are really good efforts around the country, but there's not a 21st century digital media literacy curriculum, and I think that's really important, and cyber should certainly be a part of that as well. I'll stop there.
And July 9, Bloomsbury is your publisher, and That's when the book's coming out.
Yes, well, theoretically, it could change between now and then, but it is on Amazon, available for pre-order now.
Fantastic. Nina Jankowicz, the first Disinformation Fellow.
Yes.
It's fantastic. You're doing important work, and it's great to see events like this. It was also great to see Chairwoman Harman here as well join us. It's always a pleasure hearing from her and talking to her.
Great.
Best of luck, and look
Thank
forward
you.
To talking again.
Thank you so much.